Rich Russo, host of Anything Anything on DHA and the Rat here. Also, the Jersey guy does Jersey on Sirius XM, so I feel I have a little connection here to be up here. But we're going to bring up a real Jersey guy who's actually, it's fitting that we're doing this in a record store because he is a major, major record collector. So I'm assuming after this all happens, he's going to be shopping for a little bit. Please don't bother him. Let him shop. Let him spend some money. Let him buy some records and do some cool things. Of course, we know there's a couple rules. Gary's going to sign the album that you would have bought here or the poster that we have. He can't sign anything else, obviously. We got a lot of people here. We want to make sure that Gary enjoys the rest of his day off as they have a gig tomorrow night. Also, the way we're going to do the pictures, Gary's going to sit here. He's just going to get in front of the table, and then we'll just snap the picture that way, or you'll snap it with your phone or your camera, so we're all set. And it is my pleasure and honor to bring out... Actually, when you think about the history of this guy with New Jersey music and all the cool stuff he's done, even the formation of the E Street Band, he is obviously the last original E Street Band member and also the last last E Street Band member ever to release his own solo record, which just came out called Break Time, that you're all enjoying and you got to hear. When you think about, he's the reason that Davey Sanchez and in the E Street Band, Ernest Boone Carter, he's basically played Bruce's guitar before Bruce actually had that Esquire and so many other things. You're going to ask him some questions as well. It is my pleasure. Please welcome Gary Talent.
You can use the mic standing up.
He stands all night for a show, so we're going to let him sit down and answer some questions. And let's start off. I'm going to ask a pretty easy question for you. Last night, you guys opened the show with a tribute to Prince with Purple Rain. So tell us what your feelings are on Prince and how, you know, you're a big music fan. So what did he mean to the world? And obviously, it was very sad for you guys to put together that song, but obviously how great you guys did it. So little words on Prince to begin tonight.
Well, I mean, so much has been said over the last few days. It's pretty obvious that he was one of the major talents that we've seen in rock and roll. You know, I don't think there's too many to compare with him, you know. It's a dreadful loss. I think everybody's kind of stunned. I put it on par with Elvis and Michael Jackson. And just the fact that he's so young and healthy. You know, he's one of those guys that took care of himself and didn't do drugs. But you know, that's life. That's where it goes. And we're gonna miss him. We're gonna miss him bad. And as far as the tribute, I mean, how could you not? How could you not? And then when you think about what song to do, Purple Rain was pretty obvious. So rather than try to think of something obscure and cute, we just had to do what I think everybody kind of was expecting. And I hope it turned out well.
Did it turn out well?
We've been panicking at soundcheck. How are we going to pull this off? Hopefully we did.
Are you going to play tomorrow night too?
I don't know. We'll see. Yeah,
I didn't be that. I wasn't that.
But, yeah. I don't know. I don't have the answer for you.
Thank you.
There'll be a lot of those I don't have answers for.
And Rob Roth, owner of Vintage Vinyl, has a couple of prepared questions before we get to the audience Q&A.
I'll ask you a couple of questions from here, and then we'll let people come up. I have a bunch. I won't go in order. But what was your first instrument, and what age did you pick up the bass?
My first instrument... was probably flute in fourth grade. They handed me a flute. I played on that for a while and then switched to clarinet. And yeah, it's like, I guess like kids, all kids do. I switched back and forth. When the Beatles came out, everybody had a bass. Nobody really knew what a bass did. So I played a little guitar, and in school, by that time, I'd switched to tuba. So I kind of had an idea what a bass did, and so everybody needed a bass player. I didn't have a bass, so I just borrowed one from Southside Johnny. Because he couldn't figure out what to do with it. So I became a bass player.
Well, I guess that answers also one of my questions, is how did you come to play tuba on Wild Billy Circus? So that's because you played tuba. Yeah. Were you in the marching band?
Yeah, I hated marching season. A little skinny kid carrying a sousaphone is pretty ridiculous. Why do they give the biggest instruments to the smallest kids? I'll never know that.
They're sadists.
That's all there is to it.
I'll ask one more question before I turn it over, and then I have more, but okay, so Bruce always calls out a lot of songs from the stage. How many songs approximately do you think you could play at like the drop of a hat?
Depends on what songs.
Well, that's the question. Do you have a repertoire?
Probably thousands.
Thousands. Yeah. Did he ever pull out a song that you never heard before and had a play that you didn't even know the song?
Yes. I couldn't tell you exactly.
So you were able to fake it?
Yeah, usually. I don't know how well, but you're kind of stuck in that position. So, my mantra is when in doubt, lay out. So, it's pretty easy to hear it once, and then you can pick up on it.
Cool. All right, I'll open this up to anyone who wants to come up and ask a question. Why don't you come up here?
I'm gonna try.
This is just like the Johnny Carson show.
Hey, Gary, I got two questions. You want the first one or the second one?
Let's start with the second one.
Second one. If you were putting together a band and you couldn't pick Max, what drummer would you pick?
Well, I put together a band back in Nashville. A fellow named Steve Eby. We played together. We just do covers and stuff. But he's a terrific drummer. He's from Memphis. And he really kind of holds the band together. We do covers of classic albums, and we only do them once, so we have like one rehearsal, and everybody just does their homework. So Steve is the one that has all the stuff written out. He knows what's going on, so whenever we get to a tricky spot, we all look at Steve, because he goes here. So, there's a... Max and I have been playing together for a long time, so we're kind of joined at the hip. But Jimmy Lester played on this record that I did, and we play in different bands. We play in a Chuck Berry cover band, and we play in our 60s garage band. You know, things we just do for fun. But Max is unique, and I think that's the E Street Band. You know. A lot of great drummers, a lot of great musicians. I like to play with a lot of different people because you learn from every one of them.
Okay, and if you can play any, what song do you, when you're looking at in the crowd and you see the sign, I'm hoping Bruce picks that sign. What's the song that you want to play?
Jeez. I always say I like the song I'm playing at the moment.
Same.
That's always the best one.
I thought these were great questions.
Great questions.
Good questions.
Thank you.
My name's Leon. Gary, you're awesome. I have a question. I'd like to know the writing process and how you contribute. Like, if we go way back to like a song like Rosalita or something, Bruce comes to you with a song. Does he instruct you or help you tell you what to do with a bass, or you just go and you do that? How do you write that? How do you contribute to that? And how's the creative process with that, with a whole song like?
For me, he's just always kind of left me alone. He said, here's the song, and, you know, you won't even tell me what key it's in half the time. run the tape, and so I guess what it is, he doesn't really pay much attention to the bass. Which is okay by me, because it gives me a lot of freedom, and he only notices if it's not there. So I just kind of, you play the song, you know, you play the song, and usually the song dictates how it should feel, or how it should be played, and also you're listening to the other players, and I think it's pretty organic, you know, there's nobody reads music, nobody has written out parts or anything like that, so it's just kind of everybody jump in and hang on.
Who are your musical influences?
There's so many. When I was a kid, I was Buddy Holly was you know, I've listened to everything that he did thousands and thousands of times. But you know, Chuck Berry, Elvis, all the early rock and roll guys, I just couldn't get enough of. And then of course, as I got older, and all the British bands, and I love all kinds of music, and I've got a lot of guilty pleasures. I listen to things by, I don't know if you know who they are, the Fleetwoods. I go, geez, that's just great music, you know. You like what you like. And a lot of stuff that other people like. And I have a lot of friends that are big yes men. I never got it. That's just the way it is. But music is art, and it's what you get out of it. And so, I never say anything is bad if you like it. It's only, if you like it, it's good.
All right, I'm going to switch topics for a second and ask you a question. I know you're an avid record collector. What was the greatest record find that you came across?
Ooh, that's hard.
Gamble Records, Moses.
Oh, God.
That's the one.
he found a record that I played on back in the 60s on some label I never knew it even came out on. So, I mean, it's like, it's all, there's always... But the best, probably the most amazing thing that I just kind of came across by accident was the Johnny Burnett Trio album.
The 10-inch or the 12-inch?
The 12-inch.
Okay, there's a 10-inch version of that also.
I don't have that.
Okay, that's a little tough.
That's English, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, the American pressing. And, you know, I had some of the singles that I found. Remember English Town Auction?
That's, sure.
Is that still going on?
That's where I started.
Oh, okay. Well, we used to go out there, you know, with flashlights in the middle of the night, and I remember finding the first Johnny Burnett single. I knew him as a pop singer, and in the 60s, and I came across Train Kept a Rollin' in his box of records, and I never knew he did this raw rockabilly stuff, and then I got into that, you know, even as an older guy. I didn't know him as a kid, and then found the album. It's like the Holy Grail.
And since you're talking about that album, let's talk about the Johnny Burnett Trio, Train Kept a Rollin' version, how that evolved into Fire.
Oh, well, oh yeah, well that's a secret. Oh, no.
Secret's out.
You said it on Sirius on my show, so okay. Everybody's heard it, but let's talk about that.
Yeah, that's the trouble with talking with Rich. I get loose tongued. No, if you slow down Train Kept a Rollin' by Johnny Burnett Trio, it goes... That's all. It's just, you know, another way of stealing stuff, which I do all the time.
And he's being modest here, and he also originally wrote the third verse of Fire, and then Bruce changed it to come up with the role of Romeo and Juliet line.
Yeah, well, he hadn't finished the song, and Robert Gordon was recording, and I knew that Bruce wasn't going to include it, so I asked him, if I could play it for Robert Gordon, and he said, "Well, I haven't finished it." I said, "I'll do the third verse," and so I did. And the next day, I was gonna go over, and he says, "Well, I thought about that." He says, "What do you think about Romeo and Juliet, Samson and Delilah?" I said, "Okay, that's it." he's the solo writer on it.
Next question.
I'm pretty sure you've been asked this 1,000 times, but what does it feel like to be idolized by millions?
I don't know. That's Prince.
Hi, Gary, fellow Neptune High School graduate.
Hold that against you.
Yeah, with your brother, Stephen. Bruce from the stage last night said those would be the final two shows where they would play the full River album in Brooklyn. And your tweet today is going viral on the internet world about the European shows. Could you expand on that a little about what will the European shows be like then if it's not full River albums or the full River album?
I heard it when you heard it. You know, he announced it last night. And I said, okay. And I said, you know, we're gonna do, he said, you know, we're not gonna do it in sequence. And so that doesn't mean we're not gonna do a lot of the songs. It'll probably be a big part of the repertoire like we always have done, you know, six, well, it's a double album, so 10 songs, I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah.
But it's gonna be more like the old shows where, who knows, you know, more of a free-for-all.
That was news to you last night when he said that to
him? I'm sorry?
Was that news to you when he said that from the stage last night? Or?
Well, he confirmed it. Landau said something about it at dinner.
Yeah.
But I don't listen to him.
Hey, Gary. Could you explain how you and Vinny Lopez and Danny Federici connected with Bruce in the very beginning, like really early on?
Well, the Upstage Club was just, you know, just a bunch of teenagers. It's kind of a coffee house. And, I knew Vinny from high school, and we played in bands together in high school. And then after high school, we formed a Moment of Truth, and we were playing all the clubs on Kingsley Street, Student Prince, and all that kind of stuff. And I played with Vinny and Danny in the downtown Tangiers Rock and Rhythm and Blues Band with Ben Chinnick. And, you know, I think it just kind of morphed into what happened. And I think that the reason Vinny's probably not still in the band is the fact that really started out as being his band. And when he realized, or when it became apparent that, you know, things were changing, he wasn't very good with that. But he really did start the band, and they were reforming the Moment of Truth, and they needed a guitar player. And Vinny and I were fighting at the time, which we've done quite a lot over the years. He's a dear friend, but he's Vinny. And so he needed the guitar player. And the story that Bruce always tells about me dissing him at the Upstage is... that's his version of it, but the fact is it wasn't Southside and myself, it was Danny Federici who had, you know, saw Bruce come to the Upstage the Saturday before, and he said, come on, you gotta hear this guy. And so it was me and Danny, they were sitting there listening to him, and Danny wanted to, you know, he and Vinny were thinking about asking him to join the band, and I said, by all means, this guy's great. So I wasn't dissing him. It was pretty obvious that he was the talent that he's turned out to be.
And speaking of Vinny, the first time you guys actually played together in a band was because your previous drummer got kicked out of the band at a high school for using a vending machine, right? And that's how Vinny became in the band, and then it led to obviously all these other things. Tell that story. That's a great story.
Well, in high school, we had a little band that was part of the talent show, and after the talent show, then it kind of became a thing that we would go to other schools and put on the talent show at the other schools. And the drummer, a guy named John Erb, are you here, John? I don't know what happened to John. Well, we went to Ocean Township High School. And at the time, they had vending machines. We had never seen a vending machine in the school. That was really cool. But, you know, the band director said, nobody go near the vending machines. So John just has to go by the vending machine. And so he got thrown off that was our tour. So we needed a drummer. And Vinny was a classmate and a friend. And he played with Sonny and the Starfires, which was like, you know, they were the biggest rock and roll band in the whole area, and that's when he started filling in for us with the in the talent show, and he just kind of became our drummer. I think we played 3 years after that. But yeah, it all started with an ice cream.
A few more questions?
Anybody else got it? You want to come up here so you can?
I can hear you.
Right. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, hi.
Oh, yeah, sure. Do it so we can hear
the microphone. Oh, so everybody.
So everybody can hear you.
Yeah.
Oh, careful. Hi, Gary. Careful, careful.
Hi.
I've spent a lot of time in Nashville, and I know you have too. And I'm interested to know if you've ever been, have you ever played at the Bluebird?
Oh, many times.
Yeah.
Geez,
such a great place.
I think it stinks.
That's great for the audience.
The audience, it's a little bit precious. I work with the First Amendment Center down there, and every year we do a show basically doing music that was banned somewhere along the line. So it's freedom of speech, and so I've done that for the last, whenever I could, usually in September, October. Mm-hmm. And so I've been doing that for years. But yeah, I played there many times with many different people. And it's because of the TV show, it's gotten so popular that it's always sold out now. I used to go there and hear, Michael Henderson plays there. Yeah. He's been playing there Monday nights for the last 25 years. And usually it was just kind of me sitting on the bar stool all by myself listening to this band. Now it's packed every night.
Yeah.
So good for Michael. But I always thought, I'm probably talking too much about it, but I always thought that the Bluebird was not doing a performer any favors by shushing the crowd when they're serving alcohol and all that. It's the performer's duty to get their attention, not to have the waitress shushing people and listen, forcing them to listen to the music. It's like you're not doing the performer a favor. He's got to learn how to do that for himself.
I'm with you. I hate that.
It's stupid, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm there to rock and roll, and you want to tell me that I can't? They give me money back. I'm leaving.
And it'd be another thing if they didn't serve alcohol.
Right. Well, you can't serve people booze, and think you're going to tell them how to act.
Yeah. But that is the Bluebird, and it's kind of got that reputation, and they kind of like it. And I I'm not there on a shush night. I'm only there on anti-shush nights.
Which nights are those? Because I got to go to Nashville, and I want to talk to you about something.
Well, you got to go see Michael Henderson on Monday night. Okay. And it's hard to get in now. It used to be, but he's an amazing guitar player. He's always got an amazing band.
Can you get me on the list?
We can work on it. Michael's a pal. We shoot the snooker together.
No, I kid you not, all right? I'm a vet. I got something new and improved. I don't want to put it on the video. So I need to talk to you someplace else.
Okay.
There you go.
It's in a super secret location in Colts Neck on the 1st of October. I need you. All right? But I know you live in Nashville.
Always trust the man with the top hat.
Oh, wait. See, this is the part where I firmly believe that the...
Was that stovepipe hat? That's anyway.
It's built right. My gig,
it's Lincoln.
Okay. I firmly believe that the odds of someone watching you are directly proportional to the stupidity of your actions. So I'm willing to do whatever it takes. All right? There you go. Maserati. We'll travel,
We'll close out the Q&A and we'll get you signing. I got Tom Cunningham up here. We all know Tom Cunningham from the Bruce Brunch. And coupled with the fact that Gary's album is sold out here, Tom is gracious enough. There are 5 copies left in the world of Tom Cunningham's Bruce Brunch 10-inch single, which is right there on that wall. These are the 5 copies left in the world of 500, the only ones left. So if... you're so inclined, you want to buy that. But Tom Cunningham, of course, who probably has a bazillion questions for Gary because they've known each other forever, is only going to ask him one right now. Here's Tom Cunningham.
Hey, Tom. Hey, Gary. It's a two-part question. As we're here in this great shrine of vinyl, you really made it a point, obviously, to get break time out on vinyl, which is a beautiful thing. Knowing you, that's not a surprise. And like your thoughts behind that, and B, the record collection that you maintain with Southside Johnny, how are you the only guy on the planet able to get along with him and to keep this record collection in mind?
Well, who said I get along with him?
Well, that's true.
Now, Johnny's one of my best pals. As I said before, when I was a kid, Johnny's... we always called him Mr. Bluster, but he's one of the sweetest guys on earth. And I was working in a music store,
and he and his father came in, they bought a bass and an amplifier, and I sold it to him. So that's where I met him. I didn't know him in school. I was new in school, but I knew, and he was a friend of Vinny's, and they were close. So anyway, I just met him, got to know him there. And when I had the opportunity to join a band, they wanted me to play bass. And I didn't have a bass. So they said, it's okay, we just won't tell our bass player that he's fired. And you can just use his gear. So I practiced for like a month with his band and using this other guy's gear that I never met. So of course, the night of the gig, the bass player gets wind of, a gig is going on. He doesn't know anything about it. So he comes along and takes his gear. I don't blame him. So I was stuck, and I called up Southside and asked him if I could borrow his new bass and his amp. And he said, yeah, but you got to meet me down the street. So he snuck it out of his house because his father would have gone crazy. So he snuck it out of the house and lent it to me. That's pretty sweet, you know. It's you wouldn't expect it from his persona, but he's one of the sweetest guys in the world.
Mr. Gary W. Kellen. So now we will do the signing. Thank you for the candidness and all the answers to the great questions. Gary is going to sign the Breaktime album that you bought, or he will sign the poster if you'd bought that. That's all we're going to be able to sign for him. We're going to take the mic down, and he's going to just, you'll get in front of the table, he'll take a picture, and that'll be that. And let's start the line. And
we're
going to
line
everybody
up. The line's going to start over here and go straight back to the wall and then up that way.
So you're going to have to go that way.
I just pulled the
plug. I got it. It's all good.
So you're good.
All right. So you're going to be on that line.
Right. And then we're just going to go on the other side of it, or? No. Oh, Bernie will be here. Okay.
I feel like I'm standing up for me.
So we got two restaurants?
Yeah,
nice crowd.
Yes.
Okay. You have name that you're going to be signed for?
One to Mike.
Chuck. Okay.
Ahead,
get on,
I'll take
one, two Mike, one, two Chuck.
No, you can't go behind.
Okay. Up here.
Okay, I'll take
the
picture.
Are you Mike or Chuck?
I'm Chuck. I'm
Thank you. Wow, look at this shirt.
Hey, I'm ready.
Better take it with you. Amazing.
And then you can throw them in here.
Okay. Hey. Thank you.
Good looking.